Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. So we've come to the end of this particular series of classes on early Ashkenaz. And the last couple of classes have been really tough because we're looking at, you know, the blood libel and host desecration and the Black Death and expulsions. Yikes. But thankfully, it ends on an up note because although Jews are being driven from their homes in Western Europe, Eastern Europe is turning out to be a haven for Jews. And in fact, Poland, which is later united with Lithuania in a massive commonwealth that stretches from the Baltic to the Black Seas, will actually be like this beautiful new home for Jews for several hundred years. And Jews will sort of riff on the term Poland in Yiddish, Hebrew, excuse me, as Polin, which means in Hebrew, here we will rest, here we find refuge, and so on. And this is because whereas in Western Europe had all these negative things going on, in Eastern Europe there was a recognition of the value the Jews had to initiate the economy, and so they were actively attracted into the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and offered the possibility of settlement there to engage in various economic functions to which the largely agrarian population was not well adapted. And we see this, for example, here's a beautiful example of a Jew, kind of like a Jewish family really, coming to Poland and seeking the refuge there, and the king, who is up on the stairs, is magnanimously saying, well, you know, basically, why don't we let them in? I mean, they seem like nice people, right? So this is especially noted in the various charters extended to Jews, like the Statute of Kalisk, which is shown here, a 13th century statute. This is actually a remarkable representation of it by the great 20th century Polish Jewish artist Arthur Sick, who is saying, like, look how amazing it is that the Polish kings actually viewed the Jews positively and would invite them to the region. Jews were heavily involved in the early economy, as some of the earliest coins that come out of Poland actually have Hebrew lettering on them, like this one here, which says Meshko Karol, or King Meshko, written right on the coin, because, you know, the Jews were the early mintners, as well as engaging in all kinds of other economic activities. And so by the time you get to the 18th century, you see in this map here, large populations of Jews throughout Poland, and you know, it would constitute really the bulk of Ashkenazic Jewry going into the modern period. Although Jews in Poland would still retain the definition of themselves as Ashkenazic, which harkens back to Germany, they would nevertheless be overwhelmingly concentrated in the East, far more than they would be in Western European countries. And at the pinnacle of their activity there, which goes beyond the time frame that I've really set for this mini course up until about the year 1400, they would create something absolutely fantastic called the Council of Lands, sometimes called the Council of Four Lands. And this was basically a uniting of all of the kehilot, all of the communities, the municipalities of Jews throughout the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in a single coordinating body, which in many ways allowed the Jews to function on a meta level, almost on a state within a state level, making sure that they regulated their internal behavior according to Talmudic law that was particularly occupied with things like, you know, commercial law and marriage law, and ensured that men who did not give their wives a get were still under the authority of the overarching Council of Lands. This is a page of minutes from the Council of Lands. And according to many historians, following the thought of Shimon Dubno, shown here, a great historian from Eastern Europe, this represented really a high point in Jewish civilization as a whole, because the Jews had sort of evolved to a point where they could exist as a society, fully participating within the diaspora environment without having to have a state of their own. Dubno, of course, was non-Zionist. He lived at the time when Zionism proved to be an extremely powerful phenomenon, and most Jews actually supported Zionism, but he felt that Zionism actually was a step backwards for the Jews, that the Jews had already evolved past the need for a state, that they could maintain their communal existence without connection to a state. Sadly, Dubno himself was killed by the Nazis, along with most of the people who did not see the value in having a Jewish state, at the very least, as a refuge for Jews in the face of anti-Semitism. But nevertheless, it's fascinating to think about what the Jews could achieve within their diaspora environment under the Council of Lands. And that takes us to the end of this particular section of classes. I hope you found this mini-series useful, and I wish you tremendous success in your journey studying Jewish history. Thank you very much for watching.